Richard Curtis writes romantic comedy films, and sometimes they get a bit out of hand. This time around, it's called Yesterday, and it makes so much no sense. Luckily, trailers in 2019 show the entire film in 3 minutes, so I can get by just watching that. So Jack is a struggling singer-songwriter playing generic rock pop with a bit of a Beatles vibe. You know, guy with a guitar, mild distortions, simple blues cadence. He's probably a bit shoddy, derivative, nothing much to listen to in 2019. Then there's a magical worldwide power cut and he's hit by a car, maybe a baby was driving. Then in some contrived way, he ends up playing Yesterday and everyone's listening intently and his S's are fine despite his missing front tooth. And Yesterday is new to all of Jack's friends, who have to presume he wrote it. He lets them know that he didn't write it, someone else wrote it, but they've not heard of Paul McCartney.
Who?
And somehow this bit where he directly credits authorship to the actual Beatles is buried, I don't know, concussion or something. There's a good little joke when he's flaunting Yesterday.
It's one of the greatest songs ever written.
Well, it's not Coldplay. It's not Fix You.
You see, in a world unaware of the Beatles, someone else would have to be held up as pop music's paragon. And choosing a band and song as heinous as Coldplay and Fix You shows how bafflingly different a world without the Beatles would be. Except Coldplay are big Beatles fans who rode in at the start of the century on a wave of sentimental anthemic pop in a rock band format in the groove of Let It Be by the Beatles or Hey Jude by the Beatles, and this musical movement was a reaction against the 90s popularity of alternative rock, which was spearheaded by Nirvana, famously huge Beatles fans. Coldplay's most direct influence was Travis, who were initially named Glass Onion after a Beatles song. You can't invent this parallel dimension without the Beatles and then throw in contemporary references that wouldn't exist without the Beatles. Unless you're Richard Curtis and science fiction history-changing plot holes mean nothing to you compared to the story of a shy but earnest but deceptive straight man. Of course, Jack gets a new tooth, visits his parents in the 1970s, and ends up with an opportunity to make a ton of money.
A ton of money.
Yeah, a ton of money. So, I guess he's manipulated into manipulating everyone into thinking he wrote these songs and they're a revolution. Well, you know, we all want to change the world. Except, it is the present day. There's Coldplay and smartphones and, oh, Ed Sheeran. The Beatles songwriting is remarkable in a 1960s context, and it influenced everything since. It's like the common ancestor of pop music. I mean, the white man's common ancestor of pop music, but that's the dominant culture, so they're historically imperative. Without an understanding of that context, thrown into the present day with everything they've inspired, their music would be unspectacular. It's not like newer music is better, or the more complex music is better, but the Beatles transposed to now could no longer be innovative or special because everything they inspired would have come before them, where once they were innovative, they would now be imitative. Nevertheless, Jack's supernatural pilfering brings him international stardom and he ends up on the James Corden Show. The James Corden Show is, of course, an awful byproduct of the American crush on anything British that started with Beatlemania. Anglophiles. James challenges him to come up with a new song right there and then, echoing the famous story of how Paul McCartney wrote Hello Goodbye. Then he plays George Harrison's Something instead, with no evidence of it not being prepared in advance, and gives meaningful looks to the deceived woman he pretended to write it about. Ed Sheeran is hugely influenced by the Beatles. If you're just blanking them out of the timeline without wiping their consequences, you've got to explain every single one of their consequences. I want to know about the Rolling Stones, or the Traveling Wilburys, or Oasis, or every damn bit of pop culture since the Beatles. I hope this film is just 105 minutes of 4-second long screenfuls of expositional text. It is at least aware enough to portray Ed Sheeran as god-awful at lyrics.
Let me just give you this advice. Song title. Hey Dude.
He's a good sport for playing himself like that, and maybe he can learn from this. The one thing the trailer doesn't show is the fallout when two men turn up claiming to be the true writers of Jack's songs. One of them is barefoot, implicitly Paul McCartney. The other one is, well, it's gonna be Ringo Starr, but in their universe, the other primary songwriter, John Lennon, could easily still be alive, because Lennon was killed because he was famous. I really hope it's Lennon. So what is the magical plot device? It's not a global human amnesia, because there's no written record of the Beatles. It can't be that they simply didn't exist, because they turn up at the end. It must be that the real Beatles happened but never achieved fame, which makes sense for the first couple of years, but they wouldn't have stayed together and writing songs for a decade if they weren't successful. There wouldn't be a Let It Be. They'd be off working in a quarry somewhere. But if these songs automatically cause adulation like they're shown to in the present day, then they would have in the 60s, so they'd be chronicled somewhere. Now, of course, this all happens after Jack's injury, so it could just be brain damage or a coma dream. Whichever way, being a Richard Curtis film, it'll definitely end with straight people having children. I just can't wait for the sequel where he runs out of Beatles material and has to move on to Wings.